If from your old... That's not the one you want to hear. Wrong song. See there? One day, I heard a voice. He said, if I make him my choice, he'd take away my every sin and set me free. So I came to him that day, and he took my sins away. Now I don't want nothing here to hinder me. I don't want nothing here to hinder me. For someday his precious face I long to see. It makes no difference what the cost or how heavy may be my cross. I don't want nothing here to hinder me. And one day when I reach home, then I'll never more shall roam, and the angels that my Savior I shall see. Then I'll be glad I was born, and receive that shining crown, and I'll be glad nothing
cross down and tender knees. I don't want nothing to hinder me. For someday His blessed face I long to see. It makes no difference what the cost or how heavy beneath my cross. I don't want nothing here to hinder me.
So many times I'm tossed about, so many times I do without. So many times my heart is burdened down with fears. But I know if I stand true, that one day He will see me through. If I don't care, I don't want nothing here to hinder me. For someday His blessed grace I long to see. It makes no difference what the cost or how heavy. So many times I do without, so many times my heart is burdened down with tears. But I know if I stand true, that one day He will see me through. If I don't bear nothing here hinder me. I don't want nothing here to hinder me. For someday His blessed grace, oh God, I want to see. No difference what the cost or how heavy may be my cross. I don't want nothing to be with me. Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen, amen. That's my song tonight. Praise God. I wanted to say that I'm so glad to see everyone on the job, and I know it's seem like we're going through a lot right now. Isn't that good?
Yeah.
Said, "Oh, that's bad." Oh no, that's good.
That's good.
That means God loves us.
Amen.
Because He wants us to make it.
Mm-hmm.
And but I was thinking about a passage of scripture, excuse me, that I was looking at this week. If I can find it real quickly, I'd like to share it with you and see if God's in it. Thank you.
If I had a tough topic, and I do have one, but not supposed to, but I do have one. But my topic would be how to deal with despair and disappointment. How many like to learn how to deal with that?
Yes.
You know, that's what a lot of us are going through that right now.
Yeah, we are.
And I think it would be I think it would be a valuable lesson for us to have you know, to say, okay, God's going to work it all out is one thing. Yeah, that all sounds good, but yada, yada, yada. But sometimes I think it's, if we go through something despondent, discouraging, and to shake us, then Lord will let us go through it again if we don't learn the lesson the first time. And he'll let us go through the lesson again the third time, the fourth time. Sometimes we might go on forever with it, because it is a repetitive thing sometimes, the things that we go through, because we don't know how to cope with them.
Yes. Amen.
And we don't know how to handle them.
Amen.
You know, sometimes people, there's some people that you know, they have problems financially, and I'm not, you know, I'm not saying this to anyone intentionally, but if it is you, it's for you, well then take it and run with it. But sometimes we have financial problems, and sometimes it's because we don't know how to manage our money right.
Yes.
And I've seen people do that. You know, they'll spend money on things that are absolutely, if you excuse the term, asinine.
Yes.
There's no purpose in it.
Mm-hmm.
And if I spend money to try to impress somebody, that's pretty stupid. And then I don't have the opportunity to pay my light bill and have trouble paying my water bill or a payment of some type. Well, that is due to my own ignorance. And sometimes people go through financial dilemmas and all they have to do is go get a job, you know. People, you know, sometimes, well, there's jobs out there that, you know, I don't like, but I have to do them because I have to have an income.
Mm-hmm.
And when I was running a business, there were jobs that I absolutely despised. I didn't want to do for people, but I did them because it was an income. It was a source of income. And those are things that we can, those are natural things that we learn through. I think dealing with despair or disappointment, I think the definition of despair would be to lose hope and confidence or a point of being disappointed. How many have ever felt that way?
Yes.
Just kind of really be disappointed and go through despair and you start to lose hope.
Yes.
Hope or confidence in something. And I you know, I was looking at David. You don't know who David was. David was one of the kings of Israel. And he was a mighty fellow. He was the guy that slayed the lion, the giant. He also did some lions, but he's most commonly recognized for slaying the giant. And remember how he slayed the giant? He didn't have a big sword in his hand. He didn't have a big weapon. All he had was a slingshot and five smooth stones. Somebody said, that's a fairy tale. Well, you've come too late to tell me that, because I've already felt that spirit that David had.
Yes.
To fight the battle and to keep on fighting the war. David, in the 21st chapter and the 22nd chapter, talks about David and talks about his place, and in his lifetime he obtained a lot of things in his lifetime. He was a shepherd boy to begin with. He was the son of Jesse on the backside of the desert. He was out there minding his own business, and then he wasn't even accepted when the prophet came. And the prophet, or rather, he was accepted, but the prophet, but he didn't wasn't recognized until later on in life. And David. David came from the backside of that desert and came to the children of Israel while they were in battle with the Philistines. And they were fighting the Philistines. And that guy was the biggest, you know, he was a jerk, but he was the biggest, you know, built guy at that time frame. He was a giant, you know, and he was probably 8 foot tall. And it's not impossible. There have been people 8 foot tall.
Mm-hmm.
You know, somebody said, where are all those giants at? Well, there were giants. And, you know, there have been people 8 foot tall. You look in Wikipedia, it'll tell you.
Yes.
That and these were men that were strong and very fortified. And they remember then that giant, his voice was when David come to him, he said, what in the world are you guys sending me? A little stripling of a boy. And that's what you guys got. That's what you guys send. He's got more brass than any of you, you know. And he asked David, he said, what are you coming with? He said, well, I don't come with any sword. I don't have any weapon. All I come with is the name of the Lord. You know that when a person lets the name of the Lord triumph in their heart, doesn't matter what comes against them. Doesn't matter what opposes them. It doesn't matter. The carnal man will let you get disappointed, let you get down and get discouraged. But sometimes trials come and tests come, and they're prolonged by the experiences of life. But David, in his lifetime, David came to a position to where he lost. Now remember this guy, David, he was a shepherd boy. He went from a shepherd boy being anointed to be the next successor to the throne of Israel. That's what David was. He went from a shepherd boy to the successor of the throne of Israel. He was a war hero. He was labeled as a war hero. He became the chief musician in the king's household. That's what David's position was. Now you talk about having it. Man, that guy had it made, didn't he?
Yes.
He had it. He had all the things going for him. Everything was going in his direction.
Mm-hmm.
And then Jonathan come knocking on the door. How many know who Jonathan was? Jonathan was Saul's son.
Mm-hmm.
And Jonathan came knocking on the door, and he said, David, you better get out of here, because my daddy is out to get you. He's out to get you. And David turned his back on all the successes that he had, and he went and hid in a cave. He went and hid in a cave with the destitute, with the poor, with the people that were in trouble with the law, with the people that were scourging around trying to make it. And he went and lived in that cave. And then, now this same David that once put his dependence on the five rocks that he had and a slingshot,
yes,
went back to the high priest, Abimelech, I think it is, but went back to the high priest where he had left Saul's, or rather the giant's sword, left it there, and instead of depending upon the Lord helping him, he went back to the condition of that sword, back to the sword of, I forget the guy's name, what was the giant's name?
Goliath,
thank you. And he went to get Goliath's sword, and he lost every bit of what he had built up in the natural, all the security he had overnight. He lost it. Every bit of the security that he had. He fled to the temple to get that sword, and he wanted to have a weapon. David lost his vision completely. He lost his vision on what it was to serve the Lord, what it was to depend upon the Lord. He was seeking for protection from a natural sword. How about that for a reversal? That was a reversal in David's life. But David started looking. He was trying to hide from his condition. He was trying to get away from it. He went to the high priest, as I said, and he lost everything, and it wasn't even his own fault. But now here, the 34th book of Psalms, 34th chapter of Psalms, I'd like to put that on the board. Here is how David finally succumbed. He was succumbed. He was in a place, and this is how he overcame his depression. David was depressed. David was in sorrow. David had lost everything. No fault of his own. He lost it all. Destitute. Desperate. To a point where a lot of us can be in life, can't we?
Yes.
Can be into that position. But here is the way that David overcame his depression. This is how David overcame his despair. This is how he did it. The book of Psalms. You ought to record this in your Bible. Highlight it. This chapter will bring you out of the desperation. It'll bring you out of the condition of hurt and pain. David said, first verse, I will bless the Lord all the time. His praise continually be in my mouth. Step number one. Everybody with me?
Yes.
Step number one. Somebody said, oh, come on, Brother Zonneville. I'm giving you a simple key of understanding that will bring you out of the desperation of all the things. Just remember, someone said it tonight, everything in this life is temporary.
Amen.
But what he gives us is eternal.
Amen.
He is eternal.
Yes.
The life that he wants to give us is eternal. But he said, I will bless the Lord all times. That means my hard times, my good times. A lot of people come to church when things are going good. A lot of people praise God when things are good. But David learned that while things are bad, he's still worthy to be praised. He's still worthy to be honored. He's still worthy to be lifted up. In the middle of his disappointments, in the middle of his despair, David lifted up his hands and praised the Lord. Try it with me. Just lift your hands right now and praise him. Blessed be the name of the Lord. In the midst of despair, in the midst of trouble, David found this secret to finding out how to sustain himself and to have life in his spirit. And he learned to praise the Lord continually. Not just once in a while, not when I feel good, not just when everything's going right, but when everything is going wrong, when things are going right, I am to praise him continually.
Bless your name, Lord. Bless your name, Lord.
Not just when things are going well, not just when the bills are paid, not just when the health is stable, not just when things are, you know, everything is going my direction. No, David says that he will praise God in all things at all times.
Yes, yes.
What was David doing here? 22nd Psalm, 3rd verse says, "Yet you are holy, O you who are enthroned, or inhabits the praises of, upon the praises of Israel." By praising God in this situation, David was bringing God right in the middle of his trouble.
Yes, he was.
See, he dwells in the praises of his people, does he not?
Amen.
He dwells in the midst of his praises, yes, of his people. He's,
yes,
enthroned. That is, he inhabits the praises of his people. He's enthroned in the praises of his people. If he's right enthroned in the praise,
yes,
of his people, while you're going through a hard time, if you'll praise him, he'll be right in the middle with,
yes,
in, with you,
yes,
in the hard time.
Yes, he will. Yes.
Praise,
amen,
the name of the Lord.
Yes.
He'll be there with you.
Yes, he will.
Is it always necessary that God works out a problem?
Yes.
Is it always necessary? You know, sometimes people use God as a tool, you know.
Yes.
God, if you make this work out for me, you make this work out for me, I'll come to church, I'll serve you,
yeah,
I'll be with you, I'll recognize you, I'll glorify you, and then,
mm-hmm,
it doesn't happen.
Mm-hmm.
Doesn't happen. What happened to the deal?
Yeah.
The deal's gone. But you know what? I'm going to serve God whether things are going right,
mm-hmm,
or wrong.
Yes.
How many are with me right now?
Yes.
I'm going to serve him whether it's right, whether it's wrong, whether everybody comes against me or opposes me. If there's two or three sitting in this assembly, I'm going to preach the gospel.
Praise your name, Lord. Amen.
Because that is what God called us to do.
Yes. Amen.
God didn't call us to back up and be overcome by the carnal nature, the carnal flesh. Things are temporary in this life. And God inhabits the lives, he lives with them. He lives right in thrones and the praises of his people. He's right in the middle of the praises,
yes,
of his people. How many can feel the Lord when you were praising him a while ago?
Yes, absolutely.
It works, doesn't it?
Yes,
how many know
does.
That it works?
Yes,
praise
it
God.
Yes,
it does.
Yes, absolutely.
Middle of a problem, middle,
amen,
of a condition.
Amen.
Praise,
amen,
God.
Yes,
hallelujah.
The Lord.
Somebody might look at you and say, you're dumb, you're ignorant,
but
let them go ahead and say that.
Yeah.
It doesn't really,
yes,
matter,
no,
because you know that,
yes,
if you praise,
yes,
God,
yes,
he is,
Lord,
right,
yes,
in the middle,
Lord,
of those,
yes,
praises,
yes,
and he'll,
yes,
be right in the middle of the problem.
Jesus.
He'll be,
yes,
right,
Lord,
there in,
yes,
the middle of that problem.
Yes.
Nobody else might,
yes,
see,
yes,
it, but you'll see him,
yes,
and you'll feel him,
yes,
and praise,
yes,
God.
Yes.
Blessed be the Lord. He's there, right in the midst.
Yes.
Second,
yes,
verse now, the second verse of that chapter. My soul will make its boast in the Lord. The humble will hear it and rejoice. A soul is the very seat of man's emotions. Do you know that? That's the very seat of your emotions.
Yes.
And most often, the source of man's most difficult problems. Right in the midst of my heart, my spirit. Oh, God, I hope you understand what I'm trying to convey to you right here. That right the midst of our emotions,
mm-hmm,
is where we're tried.
Yeah.
Not on the outside.
Oh, yeah.
We're tried right,
mm-hmm,
in the midst of our emotions.
Yeah. Yeah.
The very depth of our emotions. You know,
yes,
that, you know that the devil knows exactly where to get you?
Yes, he does.
He knows exactly where to work.
Yes,
he works right in the very inner part of,
yes,
your,
yes,
Of your, you know, of your emotions, of your, what you hold dear, what you have,
yes,
close to you, what,
yes,
what you feel,
yes,
so close to.
Amen.
That are the things that the flesh, that the devil, the contrary Adam, is going to work on, and that is what's going to cause you to lose your connection with the Lord. If you allow that to overpower you,
yes,
and overtake you.
Yes.
But here again,
yes,
praise,
yes,
God,
yes,
I'm going to praise,
bless
him,
name,
to
Lord,
break,
amen,
the connection,
amen,
or the,
yes,
hold,
Lord,
the that the Adam nature has on my life.
Jesus.
And I'm going to concentrate.
Amen.
I'm going to focus on the goodness of God rather than the bleakness of all the surroundings that are around me. I'm going to concentrate on the very goodness of God. I mean, you're looking at right now. Focus on the goodness of God. Don't focus on the bleakness of your surroundings, but focus on the goodness of God.
Amen.
Sometimes we just have to pull ourselves up by the bootstraps. And say, we're going to serve God regardless.
That's true.
Just absolutely make your life a commitment to the Lord.
Absolutely.
And pull yourself up by the bootstraps.
Yes.
And that you're going to think according to God's will.
Amen.
That you're going to focus according to God's will. And that you might be able to have a condition that you might be surrounded with, you might be succumbed with, but right now. Now let me tell you something, there are conditions in our assembly that you won't believe is happening right now. You know, and it's enough to make a grown man cry.
Yes.
The problems and the conditions that are all around
That's
us
true.
In the assembly. Somebody said, well, God must be against us doing this, or God must be against us doing that.
No, he's not.
No, he's not. You know what's against us? The carnal man's against us. He's fighting everything he can fight with to keep this church from doing what God wants this church to do. But guess what? We're going to praise him so he'll be right in the midst of our congregation to where we can work and labor and do what God wants us to do. Wow, see, like I'm preaching to myself as well as everybody else. And do you know what? In the third verse of this thing, David, in the first few verses, he recognized that God came right in the midst when he started praising him.
Yep.
Oh, yeah. Then David started to recognize, wait a minute, I'm going to recruit some help.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to bring in some help and make the force of God even stronger. And so David gave this thing here in the third verse. He said, oh, magnify the Lord with me.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Oh, magnify the Lord with me. And let us, that's you and I, and the neighbor next to you.
Yes.
If we'll include ourselves and do it as a group, and do it as a body, guess how much stronger that's going to be?
Amen.
He said, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together.
Amen.
Woo!
Yes.
You might be home going through something and you praise God, praise God, praise God, praise God, praise God. Lord, help me, Lord, trust me, help me, keep me. And you know what? You might text Sister Stacy and say, oh, Sister Stacy, I need you to help me, praise God. Notice what I said. Don't pray for the thing to go away.
Amen.
I'm going through something, I need God to help me, blah, 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 blah. No. Text her and say, I need for you to help me to praise God.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
Change your focus.
Yes.
Then you might go over there and you might text Brother Brian. He's over there painting and he gets that text. Oh, here we go. Another text. Okay, let me see. Yes. Praise. Help me to praise God.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
Because there's strength in numbers.
Yes, there is.
If we praise God together, so what's the source then? The source is we know that God inhabits the praises of his people.
Yes.
Now he's saying that even now he's trying to tell us and recruit us and say, look, if we get everyone praising God, how much power can that bring to the operation of the church?
Amen.
Amen.
If we all just started praising Him.
Amen.
Praise your name.
You know, today's society praising God is not what it was years ago. I'm sorry to say that, but it isn't. I remember when we used to come to church, we praised God, tears started flowing.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
People started getting up and walking
because
they couldn't contain themselves.
Yes.
Amen.
Because their praises came from the heart.
Amen.
Yes. Now praises come from this, top of the head. But when praises come from the very solar plexus of a person's heart, thank God. You know what? God can. He cannot refuse to not be with you. He cannot restrain himself.
Amen, amen, Lord.
If he wanted to restrain himself, he couldn't. Mm-hmm. Because the praises of the praises that we send him from the heart, I'm talking about.
Amen.
From
amen.
The center solar plexus of our existence.
Mm-hmm.
And we praise him. Not in a form.
Amen.
Because
amen.
A form is nothing. It's nothing.
Empty.
It doesn't produce God. But if we do it from the very sensitivity of our existence, and we praise Him, and we glorify Him, guess what? Heaven opens up.
Yes, amen.
And He hears from heaven.
Yes.
He hears from heaven. It isn't from heaven. It is He's from heaven, and He hears our praises and our spirit and our heart. And that brings in His presence.
Amen.
David learned not only to magnify the Lord Himself, but everyone, and he encouraged everyone around him to praise the Lord and magnify Him. Notice the word magnify. Everybody look at there. Word magnify, when you magnify something, what is that exactly doing? You are making it bigger, right?
Mm-hmm.
You magnify something, you make it bigger.
Mm-hmm.
And in the essence of prayer and working together, as we pray together, it makes that surrounding of our circumstances smaller. And the praises of God become to a point where He becomes greater. And the bigger and the more we focus on God rather than our problems, the more that we can come closer to Him. What do I mean by that? Do you know God is bigger than any cancer?
Yes, He is.
Yes.
Do you know that God's bigger than any financial loss?
Yes.
You know that God is bigger than any relational struggles?
Yes.
You know that God's bigger than that?
Yes.
Why would I not call upon the name of the Lord and offer Him a praise?
Amen.
And exalt Him?
Amen.
Because after all, He's bigger.
Yes.
His sister Marcia and I were having relational problems. Don't you believe God's bigger than those problems? Do you think that God is not, if we were having financial problems, don't you believe God is bigger than those financial problems? God is bigger. So what was David trying to introduce to us? He was trying to tell us that we need to exalt the Lord, because if you magnify the Lord with me, He becomes larger.
Yes.
He becomes greater. So as we praise the Lord, we can praise Him and we can look at Him, and God can give us those things that we have in our hearts to strengthen us. David overcame his problem by tapping the power of praise. Can you imagine that? Now, David sings. He said, I sought the Lord and he heard me. And he delivered me from all my fears. Oh, God.
Yes.
Can you see that? Boy, that chapter, I just want to take it and put it right in my heart, you know? They looked unto him and were lightened, and their faces were ashamed. The opposition that came against him, they started to see, why, wait a minute, there's something in David that's even greater. And so David sought the Lord, he heard deliver me, and then he looked. Let's go back up to that fourth verse right now. Here are two steps that we've already looked at. The one step was what? Praise him, right?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
The second step was what? Draw others into your praises with you.
Mm-hmm.
Now the third step is prayer. Mm-hmm. He said, I sought the Lord and he heard me. That's prayer. I sought the Lord and he heard me. And the Lord answered me. The Lord answered me. The Lord heard me. He delivered me from all my. See, when he said heard me, that means he answered him. You thank God if you pray in the right manner, you think God is just going to hear your voice? Or is he going to answer you?
He's going to answer.
He's going to answer. He's going to give you a result.
Yes, he is.
Might not be exactly the result you want, but he's going to give you a result. And so if you seek him and you seek to pray, you ask the Lord to deliver you. And here he is. And the Lord delivered me from all my fears. All my fears. Everything that come against me, against David, he was delivered from. Now, and then, and we go through tragedies with friends, family, and we're going through trials, we're going through tests, but God is able to help us and to deliver us. Now, let's go to the next verse, and the fifth verse. And they looked at him with lightened, that is with radiance, they looked at him, and their faces were not ashamed. The next verse then that David gives us then is that there's so much more to this, but I'm gonna try to wind up here with. These three steps are what I wanted to point out to you. Then the next 34th verse, there's another step right here. You had the three steps, right?
Mm-hmm.
We've covered three steps so far.
Mm-hmm.
Now the fourth step is the protection that God can offer. In 36, or in the sixth verse, he said, this poor man cried, and the Lord heard him and saved him out of his troubles. David cried, and he saved him out of his troubles, right?
Mm-hmm.
There's a protection in serving God. And then there's a God-inspired inspiration then. Now, here's one beautiful thing that you need to look at. First, we understand that God didn't give protection, but here in the ninth verse, my goodness, listen to this synopsis that he gave, or the seventh verse, isn't it? That he gave, he said, the angel of the Lord encamped round about them that fear him and delivered them. Delivereth them. That is a process that's going on. How many believe there's angels camped around this assembly?
Yes,
yes, Lord. Yes,
the angels of God are camped around this assembly.
Mm-hmm.
And the angels of God are protective of the saints of God. And they go, persuasion and protection go hand in hand. Then the book of Hebrews, in the first chapter of Hebrews 14, verse, Paul the Apostle said, and And they, not all ministering spirits, sent forth to minister for them who shall be heirs of salvation. Here we see that God sends ministering spirits, or he sends ministers to help us and to give us an understanding, just like what's happening right now, that we might overcome. 91st Psalm, 11th verse, for he will give his angels charge concerning you. Charge, that is to guard you in all your ways.
Psalms, what was that,
91? Psalms 91, 11. Here's an angel. You know that, I'm not saying this, I'm not bragging, I'm just saying there's an angel. There's an angel that oversees Brother Zonneveld. Jesus said he said, for their angels, I can't remember the phraseology now, but he was saying that their angels stand face to face with Jesus on your behalf. Your angel. You've got an angel that looks out for you, that protects you. Why would I be fearful? I've got the greatest army in the world standing for me.
Yeah,
you've got the greatest army in the world standing for you. The things in life are temporary. Everybody say that with me.
The things in life are temporary.
Say it with me again. The things in life are temporary. Say it with me again. The things of life are temporary. And they'll go on forever. I remember my children when they were little, they were running around the house and they were doing their thing and doing everything possible to make my life miserable at times. But they were little kids. But guess what? They're not little kids anymore. Those moments and those times when I'm worried about them and I'm worried about this and worried about that, that's all past.
Yes.
They don't even think about those things anymore.
No, they don't.
Then they went to their teens and, oh my goodness, that's when we really started worrying, stressing. And guess what? They got out of their teens and all that stress and worry didn't mean a hill of beans. It was gone because it's temporary. Now they're grown and they've got I've got grandkids that are 23, 24 years old. Do they worry about Poppy? No, they don't think about Poppy. They're going on with their lives. They're doing their thing.
Yes.
Because all things are temporary.
Yes.
And the sad part about it is they're going to go through the same course in life if God permits. They're going to go through the same course.
Yes.
And that's what man has done ever since the fall of the garden.
Yeah.
Man has repetitiously over and over done the same things and tried to find and fill the emptiness that's in their heart.
Yes.
And the only way to fill the emptiness is because, let me say it this way, when they left that garden, or when they committed an action in the garden that caused them to fall away from God, they not only lost the connection they had with God, but they lost the infilling of the Holy Spirit of God in their heart and in their life, and it became an emptiness. And man, ever since then, has tried to fill that emptiness and fill it with everything they could think of to fill it with, but there's only one way to fill that emptiness.
Amen.
And that's to let God come into our lives,
Amen.
Into our hearts.